We have a great panel here to talk about this with some very diverse experiences, both from the political side and from the business side, and with a heavy dose of financial expertise. And I think we're going to have a fascinating conversation. I've said to our panelists that I'd really like them to come up with some things that they think ought now to happen and who ought to be responsible for making them happen. So I hope we'll get some takeaways from the discussion. Now, that title, Development Finance to Balance the Energy Trilemma, I'm sure after a few days in the World Energy Congress, you're all very familiar with the three trilemma goals of energy security, energy equity, which means both access and affordability, and environmental sustainability. And in the wake of the Paris Agreement, we know we're embarked on a grand transition to a low-carbon economy. But as important, not just for this session, is the new set of sustainable development goals, which have at their heart that everyone should have access to modern energy services by 2030. Some estimates put the amount of investment required to meet the Paris goal of keeping the global temperature rise to below 2 degrees at about 3.5% of global GDP. Now, that's manageable, particularly as it's a question of the kind of planet we want and whether we want a planet to live on. But when you think about that, that figure is an average, and it's much, much more for developing countries. So there is a real challenge there of getting the finance to flow to where it is needed. And our panel's going to help us consider that. We know that developing countries do find it more difficult to balance the trilemma goals because actually they don't have the legacy infrastructure of delivery of energy services which the wealthier nations enjoy. But that doesn't mean they can't do it. It doesn't mean they haven't got the resources to do it. The question is, why aren't we unlocking that potential? So I'd like first to ask His Excellency, the Minister of State for Power, Works and Housing from the Government of Nigeria, Mustafa Baba Shahuri, to kick us off with a few remarks, please.
Good morning, Madam Moderator. Morning, ladies and gentlemen. In trying to balance the trilemma, delicate trilemma of energy security, energy equity, and environmental sustainability, in Nigeria, it is very difficult for most African countries because here managing present primary energy supply from domestic and external sources without jeopardizing the future. This requires reliability of energy supply infrastructure. For us in Africa and many developing nations, this is a tall order. Given the large energy demand supply gap, the weak energy supply infrastructure, and the low reserve to production ratio of depletable energy resources, low capacity to attract external finances. When it comes to energy equity, that is everyone having affordable access to energy, it is very difficult. Considering the continent of Africa has about 16% of the world population and account for less than 4% of global electricity consumption. With less than 150 megawatts of installed capacity, Africa has less than the installed capacity of Germany and about half the installed capacity of Japan. Environmental sustainability, achieving demand and supply objective without destroying the environment. Here, Africa has a very big potential because for Africa to join energy transition trend on cleaner putting, but energy supply infrastructure projects are capital intensive and require cheap long-term financing. However, it is obvious the state funding alone will not close the infrastructure gap in African countries, especially in view of the dwindling resources. But the commercial banks in these countries are stressed, are very reluctant to give such funds, partly due to lack of experience in green energy financing, and partly due to perceived political and market risks in Africa.
Minister, thank you so much. I'm sure the other panelists will want to build on your points about this terrible disparity in consumption and the need for the financing to flow from the private sector through green finance and through development financing. I think on that, it might be appropriate to ask His Excellency Suleiman Al-Herbish, the Director General of the OPEC Fund for International Development, OFID, to say a word or two, because he obviously is engaged in development finance.
Thank you, Chair. And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure and honor to be here in this very prestigious gathering. First of all, I would like to thank the WEC for inviting me to this meeting, and of course to the Turkish government and people for their warm hospitality. Thank you. Madam Chair, this session of the Congress is actually taking place in a very critical and exceptional time, because it is the first session that takes place after the passage and approval of the Sustainable Development Goals by the United Nations. And these 17 goals, which Mr. Ban Ki-moon referred to one of them last night, are very, very important to be globally binding, to be actually the global agenda from which we try to see how we can tackle some of the problems that we are facing now. Sustainable development goals are replacing the so-called Millennium Development Goal, MDG, which is 8 goals addressing all aspects of poverty except energy. Sustainable Development Goals has 17 goals, among them, actually the centerpiece of the 17 goals is the goal number 7, which is energy for all. Moreover, the financial requirements of these goals are actually discussed in July in Addis Ababa before the approval of the General Assembly of the United Nations of these 17 goals. That's something really make me optimistic that today, that's this time, we are serious. Now, when in OFID, OFID is, like you said, the OPEC Fund for International Development. It's a development institution working in more than 130 developing countries. Unfortunately, Mr. Minister, we don't work in member countries. Nigeria is a member country, so we work everywhere except our member countries. So when we saw goal number 7 as a central goal among the 17, we're delighted. Why? Because in November 2007, our countries at the level of summit instructed us to look for ways and means of eradicating energy poverty. Eradicating energy poverty, this is the first time that we hear such a commitment. And we start working on that one. The first effort we did actually to have a workshop in Abuja, Nigeria, in the second week of June 2008, and from there we started taking. Anyway, since we don't have much time to elaborate, but I would like just to say that since we received the instruction from our superiors, we start working on three fronts. One, the advocacy, where we started talking to our partners about energy poverty and the necessity to provide energy for the 1.3 billion people deprived from electricity, 2.6 still using biomass, and more than 4 million people dying from bad smoke, as the WHO always saying. And then the second one is creating alliances with stakeholders, with the like-minded institution. And the third one, which is a very important one, is doing projects on the ground, working through the public sector loans, through the private sector loans, they are all soft loans, and the grants program and the trade finance. And before I leave this point, the two things. One, of course, the financial aspect of these 17 goals are very important, and of course, it's without it we can't do so. We see how we can activate conclusions of Addis Ababa conference on that on the finance. And the second, which is very important, Madam Chair, goals number 7, and this is please bear with me. Goal number 7 is energy for all. And it is energy for all. It is the renewables. It is doubling the efficiency rate. So it is all energy. Now it is all energy. In the 17 goals, there is goal number 13, which is about climate change, about environment. So I'm afraid that sometimes we are actually changing the rules in the middle of the game. We are changing gears. We are mixing between 13 and 7. 7 is providing energy, and especially energy for the poor. We call it energy for the poor, not energy for all, because we are actually concerned about these 1.3 billion people who are deprived from electricity. At this point, I think I should stop, and then I have more points, but I don't think I have the time to complete. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's a great lead-in, actually, because we need to come back to some of those points, as you suggest. I think these three activities of advocacy, building partnerships, and actually supporting the finance are key to the future progress. Let's hear from somebody in the private sector who's actually a developer. And could I call on Mansour Humayun, please, to say a little bit about how it looks from his perspective? And if you can pick up any of the points that have been made before, that would be even more welcome.
Yeah, sure thing. Thank you. The 1.4 billion people around the world that have no access to electricity whatsoever. And in my opinion, we are a company dedicated to find a commercial solution to scale. So today we have around 70,000 households in Kenya and Rwanda that we electrify through the use of distributed solar. What I mean by that perspective is each household gets a solar panel, each household gets a battery, and each household gets a range of appliances. And the miracle of mobile, we use mobile money to collect payments from our customers. If they pay us, we switch them on. If they don't pay us, we switch them off. The fact that we can do that at scale is amazing. The other big miracle that we use is the fact of communication. We have remote monitoring and remote control on each of our system. So we can see exactly how our customers are using their products. From a customer perspective, we can actually predict failure months in advance before it happens. The fact that we can provide such level of customer service at scale is among the rural poor is absolutely amazing. Just going back to the point about who are these 1.4 billion people? Depending on whose research you believe in, their customers are spending anywhere between $5 a month to $20 a month already. They're spending that money on kerosene, candles, battery for phone charging, batteries for radios, etc. So we can come in already replacing that existing expenditure to give them modern forms of electricity for the first time. Let me just put in perspective, the cost of kerosene in some rural areas, in particular in Rwanda or you go into Congo, can go as high as $3 to $4 per liter, just because the inefficiency of the supply chain. You start from a petrol pump to a jerry can to a Fanta bottle, and then there's a markup along the way to be able to get there. In terms of what I see as an opportunity for scale, is that the time to electrify Africa, if the topic is Africa today, is today. Why? Because the technology exists, there's widespread use of mobile money, the financial innovation to be able to collect and manage customers at scale is there. And more importantly, the development goal, the international community is coming together where points like universal energy access become fundamental to ensuring an acceptable quality of life, and that gets recognized at an international scale. So far, as a company, we have deployed $40 million worth of capital out there, but that's just a small drop in the ocean of the amount of capital that we need to be able to electrify the 1.4 billion people. We need billions of dollars. So the conversation I would love to see here happening today is really how the private sector, how government, how policymakers can come together to unlock that potential. And lastly, I'm a hardcore capitalist, and I genuinely believe that the only way to electrify the world is if everyone in that cycle makes money. If the customer saves money, if the investors make money, if the note holders and debt holders actually can be secure about it. But to be able to ensure that taking place, things like guarantee institutions, things like good government policy, and things like grants are essential in the midterm to be able to go to that full commercial solution. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I think we've got a big action point coming out of that about the need for private sector and government to come together to ensure they're able to unlock this market, essentially, because, you know, sometimes people tend to think it's all about just grants and aid, but here we have a great commercial opportunity. So with that, could I ask Abir Burgul, who's the senior underwriter at the Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency in the United States, to say a little bit about what they're doing to try to play into this agenda.
I think, Joan, maybe before mentioning what we're doing, I want to give... So I work for the Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency, which is part of the World Bank, and its mandate is to promote foreign direct investment by issuing guarantees. So we kind of position it in a very important way because we service our member countries, so we listen to the governments, but our clients are investors. So we know what the hurdles, and since the topic is what can we do to unlock is really where I'm gonna put some, I guess, challenge, what's investors are challenges that they see when they go into developing countries. So again, to put it in the context, as everybody was mentioning earlier, there's 15% of the population don't have access to electricity. That's 1.1 billion, and 50% of that is in Africa. The need that was set by the Sustainable Energy Goal is to accelerate that development. And to do so, John mentioned 3.5% of GDP. The number is maybe 40 billion or so here in Africa. So it's hard to see how the public sector can actually facilitate that. And it's critical to see how the private sector is going to be playing a critical role in fulfilling this gap. I think from the financial institutions, we're still going to see that development financial institution will be the one who play the critical role in providing debt, because they have the appetite to do it in emerging countries and difficult environment, and they are also the one who can do a longer tenors. So why is it important to have a private sector? A, because they can deploy and accelerate development faster, they have the technology, and they can provide it at a cheaper solution. Then it begs the questions, why are we not seeing more of it, and what really the hurdles? So if I'm to put it in a bucket, there's a regulatory framework, microeconomic, political instability, and maybe off-takers of powers are lack of creditworthiness. Just a few points on each of these buckets. And there's much more challenges, but I'm going to put out there just the one that, in my opinion, may be the big hurdles for investments in energy sector. In many of these countries, when investors enter, the regulatory framework is not in place. They don't know if their investment, a private investment, is protected, if they have access to arbitration, if the roles between the various utilities and the private are not well defined. So that creates some ambiguity. You're also the off-taker in many of these parts of the world is a utility that is heavily dependent on subsidies from government, and the cash flow reliability is not quite there. The unavailability of a foreign exchange in particular country could be an issue because it caused a mismatch between hard currency and the local currency where power is paid in many of these countries. And finally, you're looking at environment where political instability, change of regulation can affect an investment and potentially, you know, for investment not to realize their expense. Solutions are there. Many of the solutions can be done to contractual arrangement and government guarantees that support and backstop the off-taking obligations of their utilities. PPA that denominated in dollars can fix the mismatch. So there are various ways of doing it. And we can elaborate on that later on. The part that my agency is there to do is really to provide those specific mitigants against what we call the residual non-commercial risks, the political instability, the breaching of a contract, the inability of government really to pay its obligation under a particular contract. So we step in to mitigate this specific risks for investor so these investment can actually happen. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we're seeing a picture building here, a fascinating picture of commercial opportunity and the non-commercial context in which it's going to have to try to be seized. So with that, I'd like to turn to another businessman, Mr. Mugo Kibati, who's the chairman of the Lake Turkana wind power project in Kenya. And I wonder if he might say a little bit about how he thinks these risks are impacting on what he's doing or whether they're being managed well. But in addition, of course, to the points that you brought to the panel.
Thank you very much. Allow me, because I wear two hats here, also to agree with Mansour, because as chairman of MCOPA, we're in the same business. And the transformational nature of innovations, because development finance can also be applied to innovative solutions such as being supplied by B-Box and M-Copper. We have about 300,000 homes in Kenya, and just slightly less than 100,000 in Uganda, whose lives have been transformed along the lines that Mansour very eloquently articulated, you know, completely taking a household that was dependent on kerosene, where children were studying under kerosene lamps, who now have access to proper lighting and radio and TV, connection to the rest of the world, and companies that didn't exist 5 years ago now have millions of people. You know, 400,000 households, you're talking about 1.5 million people whose lives have been transformed just in the last few years. And the potential for that is tremendous going forward. And I think both development finance institutions supporting that. I mean, we have a lot of funding from both private sector and development finance institutions, but also governments probably changing the lenses with which they look at this sector and delaying the urge to start ripping from this early stage sectors and allow them to grow and develop fast. But turning back to Lake Turkana, I think it's interesting that I speak after Abir. Because Lake Turkana, and for those of you who may not know what Lake Turkana is, this is the 310 megawatt wind farm in the northern part of Kenya. When complete sometime next year, and we're on course, will be the largest wind farm on the continent of Africa, and will be an on-grid, this is my on-grid heart project, and responsible for about 10 to 15%, depending on other sources of energy, how they develop in Kenya. 10 to 15% of the total capacity, installed capacity. And this is a project that was technically quite complex, a project of that magnitude and of a technology. Wind technology is not very, is not developed at all in East Africa. It's very new. So technically complex, complex to structure financially, as you can imagine, very remote location, and also logistically complex. We had to put up a 200-kilometer road to connect the site to the nearest highway. The government of Kenya is in the process of putting up or constructing a 400-kilometer transmission line to connect this to the grid. So, as you can imagine, a very remote location. Now, where do I think the various stakeholders, you know, can play in this? In this particular case, you had, I think, entrepreneurs, private sector entrepreneurs, who are able to see the potential for this project in a very remote location. And I think I would add to your list a bit of what private sector can do. Private sector does much better than development partners or government, has the ability to identify a possible commercial solution where government with its lenses will not be able to do. And so we had entrepreneurs who found out that the wind speeds around Lake Turkana are very high. This is an area which is amenable to very high wind speeds, and the yields for wind technology are very high. They're double what you have in Europe. In Europe, where you're talking about 30% yields, our project is at 62% wind speed yields. But the remoteness, of course, discouraged many people. And I think that in this particular case, we had a challenge. It took 9 years to bring that project to groundbreaking. And part of the reason is because development partners who, in my view, are supposed to assist Africa and other developing parts of the world to develop, kept citing the very elements, the very reasons why it is difficult to develop, the remoteness of the region, the lack of infrastructure, the dearth of infrastructure, as reasons not to get started. And so for me, that's a challenge I think I would place to development partners. In this particular case, we were lucky that we had a few development partners who understood that the role they had to play was to de-risk this project and therefore provide early stage, high risk equity investments. And so today the project is 50%. 50% of equity is held by development financial institutions. But the fact that these development finance partners came in at this stage, you know, the 200-kilometer road had to be put up through a grant. The government had to be convinced to put up the transmission line. All this allowed for now commercial equity to come in at later stage, and eventually even debt to have faith in the project. And now we have a nearly $1 billion project in a very remote part of East Africa 6 months to completion, and will provide 300 megawatts of energy to the grid, and therefore, and again, just as I conclude, to the point he made about the challenges we have, you know, this trilemma, energy security, equity, and environmental sustainability. Here you have a developing country that has a dire need for energy, working on a major renewable energy project. And by the end of this project next year, and if you add to the geothermal projects that we have, Kenya will be at above 50% of the energy installed capacity will be renewable energy. Now, this is quite challenging for poor countries to do, and I think the onus is upon development partners to also understand that, on the one hand, the new goals, the SDGs, are challenging renewable energy sustainability. At the same time, poor countries are the least resourced to be able to deliver. And so where you have a project of this nature, I think the onus is on all of us to support such projects. And I am grateful to the DFIs that actually came in and to the government of Kenya. So this was a perfect partnership of private sector, government, and DFIs. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I think we'll want to explore further some of the implications of what you said around the challenges of getting people to take a view of the opportunities and not just the risks. But could we turn to our last panelist first, who is another Mansour, Mansour Mukhtar, who's Vice President of Operations at the Islamic Development Bank in Saudi Arabia. And maybe you can say a little bit about getting the finance into these development projects for us.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. You've introduced me as Vice President, Islamic Development Bank, but let me crave your indulgence to wear another hat, even as I bring the other one out soon. I was privileged to co-chair the Intergovernmental Committee of Experts on Sustainable Financing for Development, which tried to work out ways of financing the SDGs. And over a year's period, that fed into the Addis Ababa conference. And in that context, I just want to share some thoughts with you in relation to the findings of the committee, and then situate that, I mean, basically bring in the role of DFIs, and particularly the Islamic Development Bank. I think one of the key issues that came up when grappling with this was the huge financing needs really to meet the infrastructure deficits in developing countries, and particularly in the energy sector. No question about that. But good news that there is a pool of resources, savings out there, and investors, potential investors that are willing to put down their money, to put in their money. And so really the question is, how do we, and we are talking also about the public savings in terms of government's ability to mobilize additional resources, and we talk about the role of the international community. And in this context, I think that one of the points that came out very clearly was that if there is a collective political will, we can make great progress in that. But first and foremost, it's a recognition that of the need for countries to take ownership, to provide credible leadership. That is key. Basically, that was a major issue, that leadership is key, and political commitment to address some of these issues. So you need to have a well-articulated vision. You need to have a long-term plan, in this case, for reforming your power sector. That would help a lot in terms of sending signals. And you need to put your money where your mouth is as much as possible. But we appreciate also that there is a limit as to the amounts of domestic resources that can be mobilized. And there is a crucial role for international community to provide concessional resources, largely through DFIs, to be able to facilitate. And again, the third point is that the best use of these resources is to leverage, to find a way of catalyzing additional flow from private sector. Fourth thing policies and institutions matter, and that again has featured in some of the presentations here in terms of the need to have clarity in a legal and regulatory framework if you want to attract investment, in terms of the need to have a clearly defined property rights, respect for rule of law, rules and procedures relating to procurement, taxation, etc., and a credible commitment to honoring these. There's also the issue of the macroeconomic environment, which determines the financial. So clarity, predictability, stability, and transparency in terms of the policy, regulatory, macroeconomic environment is key to really taking out some of the risks that private investors face. Beyond that, we appreciated that for infrastructure, for energy and infrastructure type projects, because of their very nature, really long gestation, long-term commitment over a period, technological changes, lots of risks, the high risks involved, that special risk mitigants are needed. And in that context, basically, the role for public, for the government, for multilateral development institutions in particular is key. I think public guarantees are very important in terms of basically compensating for this, and there are many ways of doing that, some through export credit agencies and some through MIGA type arrangements, and the Islamic Development Bank also is in a position to offer these guarantees through an affiliate that's dealing with the insurance and export guarantees. We have insurance covers that are critical, but also governments could really provide tax breaks and incentives to private investors to really reduce or make these projects more attractive. And there is also the issue of provision of capital, among other things. But one point also to note, and this message is very clear, that we must avoid a moral hazard situation where you make it really the private sector somehow abdicates the responsibility of doing proper due diligence and ensuring that it's executing this process in an efficient and diligent manner. And you also want to avoid creating market distortions in such situations. So that's the big picture part of it. But we see very important role for multilateral development banks and the World Bank, the Islamic Development Bank. Other banks are playing this role in terms of, particularly we've talked about the guarantees, we've talked about direct loans using concessional resources to leverage in terms of debt and equity, and Islamic Development Bank has been doing a lot of that in Africa. For example, we've given loans of about $6 billion to finance energy projects, and we committed an additional 1.5 in the next 3-year cycle. But again, as I said, it's a question of leveraging. We also have infrastructure funds. We have Arab Infrastructure Financing Facility that's aimed at mobilizing and leveraging support from private sector, but also providing technical advisory service to support project preparation. So through forms of project preparation facilities, if you like, that will, because of the high cost of producing this, so if you're able to assist in developing a pipeline of bankable projects, that facilitates entry of the private sector in these kinds of activities. Other areas of support that we provide, given the technical risks associated with this project, they're complex and there are governance issues, execution issues, delays, etc. We do provide technical assistance through what we call a reverse linkage arrangement, where we pair member countries. We have 54 member countries, including about 24 from Africa. So we encourage partnership between the developed member countries and those that are still grappling with these issues to facilitate sharing of experience, knowledge, and know and expertise. And this is very important, really, in execution of these kinds of projects. But we do also provide lines of credit and other facilities. For example, we've given the Turkish Exim Bank about $270 million to facilitate the participation of the investors and contractors from this part of the world and to in projects in Africa to facilitate their participation in projects in Africa. We are very active also, the Islamic Development Bank, in mobilizing resources through the issuance of sukuk bonds, taking advantage of the availability of funds. We look for Sharia-compliant instruments here. It's interest-free resources that we raise, but it's based on the sharing of risks and returns. The whole concept is based on sharing of risks and returns. We have project finance, sukuks, asset-backed schools, and we've worked with countries to help them raise monies, but we've also been directly involved in supporting and raising these monies and helping develop the market, among other things. So I'll stop here, and if there's opportunity, I'll contribute further. Thank you.
Brilliant, thank you. And great to have that overview after the contributions from the individual perspectives of the other panelists. What I thought I might do is pose two questions to you, and if you answer either one or both, whichever you would like, and then maybe we'll ask the audience to offer one or two questions before we round off at the end. And the two questions I have are, firstly, there is so much good work going on the part of all the parties, some of the individual country leaders, the development banks, the work to get the SDGs to where they are, the developers. Why are we not scaling up more quickly? What can we do to accelerate? That's my first question. The second is that we have some countries I know have, and I think they may include Kenya, have put in place offtake agreements which de-risk the project to a large extent. So are enough other countries following that example, and what can we do to help with that kind of risk mitigation across the continent? And if we did that, might that help with increasing the pace of development? So two questions. Anybody who wants to answer either of them, please just volunteer. Suleiman, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think I probably can comment on the first question. I think Mansour was lucky because he took much of the time. I thought we have only 4 minutes. When I mentioned at the beginning that we had that workshop in Abuja second week of 2008, actually, that workshop, probably the first workshop in the whole world dealing with eradication of energy poverty, or energy poverty, defining it and just look for ways and means of eradicating energy poverty. And we spent 2 days in bringing many, speakers from the World Bank, IMF, OPEC, UNDP, etc., and even the oil company. We have Exxon, we have Chevron, we have Schlumberger, and we came out with the conclusion that in sub-Sahara, the market has failed to solve the problem, and you need a global solution to this global debt. Then we went to how to do it. Do you do it centralization or decentralization? And we took it from there. Then we started, dealing with other countries. 50% of activities of my institution goes to Africa, actually. And we are working with the public sector, soft loan, concessional public sector, concessional private sector, and trade finance and grants. Grants, we have 6 programs. I was talking to Abir about one of them regarding the Palestinian. But even when you come to the private sector, we operate in low-income countries and without government guarantees. We support greenfield projects, and we take and take up a fair share of technical and financial risk. And we're absorbing even the risks there. So this is we are doing it through our private sector window. We are also doing this through non-conventional financial schemes. We have an agreement with Shell Foundation to provide solar lanterns to many individual countries in Rwanda, in Kenya, in Tanzania, and in Uganda. and we have an agreement with them, another agreement to cook stove. So we are trying, I'm trying here to say that we are doing our share. That why, your question, why we are moving a little bit slowly is, you know, in Addis Ababa, which is probably the most critical and most important conference to see how we can implement the SDGs. Remember, the MDGs, we stayed 2 years before we have Montreal to see how we can tackle, you know, the financial side. Now, this time, we are lucky to have the financial requirements dealt with before even the United Nations Security General Assembly approved the SDG. But in the Addis Ababa, when you come to the commitment of certain countries, the industrialized countries, you know, the so-called 0.7%. That wasn't really, it was reaffirmed again, like it's been doing for the last 20 years, but there is no time horizon for it. This is something. And actually, this includes the commitment in the Green Fund for the climate change. So it's mixing. This is one of the obstacles. I'm trying to say that I work with the Islamic Development Bank and other, we are 10 institutions, and we are taking all the risk. We are doing just similar to the Islamic Development Bank with all kind of finance. So the point I'm trying to raise is that everybody should do his homework. And by the way, Madam, I am a member of the advisory board of Mr. Ban Ki-moon, advisory board, and he's aware of what we are doing in all these institutions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I wasn't aiming that question at the panel because you wouldn't be here unless you were committed and passionate about this. So I think Mr. Ban Ki-moon is very lucky to have you. But nevertheless, there is this question about how do we accelerate. We have both Mansours want to comment. Let's start from the left and then to the right.
All right. I've never shared a panel with another Mansour before. It's very exciting. I'm a very impatient character. And today we're doing somewhere between 100 to 200 new households per day. And that's very cool, but still annoying, because we could do thousands of households per day. The limiting factor is financing at scale. Because it's the type of risk that we as a company today still need to absorb. We're still a very tiny company, although we have enjoyed early success. It's 4x risk. It's credit risk on customer. So there's a certain amount of sensibility I need to demonstrate to my shareholders to keep my job. So I need to grow it in a certain rate. If the access to capital, the cost of capital was lower, and that would accelerate growth greatly. We could easily today be doing 5,000, 10,000 systems a day across East Africa within a 12-month period if the financing accessibility was there. In terms of the other question, in terms of what are the limitation in terms of structurally, I think Rwanda is probably a good example of where regulation has come and shown maturity outside just the on-grid reality. Is that Rwanda has now officially recognized that 44% of their country will be electrified through solar home system. The fact that solar home system is not a band-aid solution towards when the grid comes, but genuinely a permanent solution and sustainable solution shows a lot. And that creates the investability profile or the bankability of that market in Rwanda in a great way. Kenya still needs to do a bit of more work on that front, and other East African countries do need to go quite forward. I hope Nigeria can show. I know there's a million solar home program going on in Lagos. So there is quite interesting progress where off-grid solar is becoming part of officials' national policy.
Thank you very much, Mansour. And then, Minister, would you like to?
Very quickly on scaling up and accelerating efforts. I think that I'm very much in favor of special initiatives that launched by leaders around the world. I mean, that would help really build consensus and strengthen the momentum for change in this direction. I know that Obama had started one really for Africa, and that's very good. I know the G20 have talked about this, and Turkish government is trying to push this forward. This really is fueled by a growing recognition of how important this is, not just as a moral imperative, but given the political and economic significance of inaction, that we need to do something. So this is very good, and this needs to be encouraged. And I want to really see also a role for special funds, special initiatives, and this is a challenge I'm throwing to the multilateral development banks and the financial community, really, in terms of being able to set up special funds for Africa, for a green fund, for example, or other special mechanisms. I think this will go a long way in really accelerating this. But we have a good opportunity here, also given the rapid jump or leap, quantum leap in technology that's taking place, the technological advances. So even though in the last couple of years you've seen very slow movement, I am really reasonably optimistic that we will see, we'll be able to leapfrog some of that and be able to make good progress in achieving this objective.
Minister, please, thank you.
In Nigeria, in Africa, there is a serious infrastructure deficit. And that means, or that requires a lot of capital. The development partners should stop hiding behind reasons. Africa has the potentials. It has the population. And especially in government pays with a lot of challenges from all sectors. That is why government is always looking out for partners to cooperate in various sectors, especially in the energy sector. In Nigeria, government had put in place policies, reforms, regulations, so as to attract investors. But still, the investment, as you said, is not not scaling up. And considering the explosion in population that we have in Africa, there is this need, immediate need, to make energy accessible to all, so as to create employment, empower people, so that investors will get back their returns.
First, I think Mugo, and then Abia, please.
Thank you. I'd like to agree with the minister. I think that one of the things that must first of all change if we're going to scale up is we need to throw out the risk modeling. The risk models that are applied to African projects today are, I think, outdated, completely outdated. I spent, in my previous capacity, I was in charge of Kenya's Vision 2030, and I spent a lot of time parting off questions about East versus West, and how come the East seems to be coming into Africa. And the only difference was, I don't think that Africa, for instance, cares to do business less with any particular party. We welcome everybody, whether they're East or West. I think the difference was less in Africa and more on the development partners. And the development partners from the East had totally different risk models and matrices, and they saw the opportunity. And were able, saw the risk, saw the opportunity, and apply de-risking factors. So the one thing I have to say is development partners need to understand that the deficit, the infrastructure deficit, the energy deficit on the African continent and developing countries is such that the opportunity is very large. And so
that's the one thing I would say. You know, in the case of electrical wind power, risks were, you know, the risks that were seen 5-6 years ago, in my view, will not materialize. The project is now well underway. Kenya needs the 300 megawatts. Kenya will become a major renewable energy center. But if the risks that had been, you know, that were being highlighted at the development phase of the project had caused us to falter, we don't have that project. And so we'd be having even less scaling than we're talking about today. I do also want to say that while I appreciate some governments, the example of Rwanda, you know, being able to better anticipate the fact that innovations will be part of the transformation of the country, I am more interested in light regulation. I am afraid if governments, you know, purport to anticipate innovation, I don't think any country can tell me today, 10 years from now, how much solar, wind, and the various permutations there will be of this energy sources will form the energy supply of East Africa, of Kenya, of Rwanda, or Uganda. I think what is more important is to ensure that regulators and policymakers do not step in the way of innovation, are light on regulation, allow innovation to lead the way, and then let regulation follow. In the case of Kenya, Kenya may not have a plan that is elaborate in terms of having solar and innovative technologies, but Kenya is pretty light on regulation, which is why a lot of innovations have taken place and regulation has followed. So the two elements would be, for development finance partners, please adjust the risk models that you use. Governments, be light on regulation. Thank you.
Thank you. Two very powerful messages there. Abir.
So, it actually fits into that. I think the reason for the lack of acceleration is twofold. First, we have some lack of capacity within certain government to actually negotiate the necessary agreements. Although there's a bunch of samples out there, it just doesn't seem to pick up the speed that it should be picked up with certain governments. I think government needs to eliminate some barriers for private investments. And really engage in serious sector reforms from the private sector. That vision that all the risk when I go into a project, I need to offload the risk on the government is also something that needs to be adjusted realistically. At the end of the day, risk needs to be allocated properly among all the parties, and really the party that control that risk is the party that should take the risk. So there's adjustment that needs to be made on both ends. PPA is an offtake arrangement that is a quick fix, in my opinion. It addresses some of the deficiencies that exist in the current environment. It's great because it facilitates a bankable project, but at the end of the day, it should not be on the expense of utility. What I'm saying is, there should be a cost recovery process in the country to make to make the utilities able to recover the cost, because then at the end of the day we're supporting projects that just add more burden on the government. And I just want to bring the example of actually scaling solar, how in Zambia, how that successful process resulted in great results. And the reason is, here we have initiative by the World Bank Advisory Services. They identified a plot of land. They came up with a template of PPA, implementation agreement, government guarantee. They issue an RFP that included in it the financial document that could be provided, the guarantee instrument, and the result was 11 qualified bidders, and the final bidders were 6 and 7 cents per kilowatt hours on solar. So this was unheard in Africa, and that's hopefully will set the tones for many more to come.
Thank you very much. Sorry, my mic needs a firm hand. What I'd like to do is take, I think I've only got time for two questions, and then only if they are very brief. Have we got a microphone? Yes, could you bring the microphone down to this lady here? And then this gentleman here.
Hello, thank you. My name is Noura Mansouri. I'm from Saudi Arabia, and I'm from the Future Energy Leaders Program. My question is for Mr. Mansour Hamayoun. First of all, congratulations. It's a fascinating company. Do you select your technologies, or do you develop them? How do you select them? And if everybody is making money, how do you cover the cost and still make it affordable to rural Africa?
Thank you very much. My name is Mike Omogwen. I am from the Nigerian Parliament. My question goes to the same gentleman, Mr. Hamayoun. When you were talking about the solar home systems, and my observation is that Africa has become a victim of just a dumping ground for poor quality technologies because of our quest to have electricity. And talking about paucity of funds, difficulties of raising funds for such development, it becomes a double jeopardy for us in Africa. I think this Congress or organization like this should find a way to regulate the technology that will be taken to us in Africa. So that, thank you very much. That's just my.
Thank you. I think that was the question about how one can actually ensure a good mix of technologies, if I interpret it correctly. Those were two such nice brief questions. I'm going to take one from the back of the hall. The gentleman right at the back with the spectacles, please. And then we'll turn to the panel. And I do apologise for the others, but you might be able to get the panellists once we've finished. So if you could be very brief, we'll have time for the panel to respond.
I'm fascinated to have heard in the last few days about how the market is moving on from energy as a commodity to energy as a service. I've heard that phrase. And I wonder if, A, anyone on the panel accepts this, and B, what effect that might have on the business model and the financing and the funding arrangements, because I do not believe that conventional debt and equity actually work. So hearing Mr. Mansour talk about the Islamic model and sharing of risk and reward, I think that is precisely the space we need to be in.
Thank you. So three questions, really, which is one very specific question to Mr. Mansour from the Islamic Development Bank, which is how you select the countries, what criteria, and maybe others in the development business might want to pick that up later. And then for anyone on the panel, how do we ensure we get the right mix of technologies and not, as it were, a second-class set of technologies in developing countries? And then this third one about whether the financing models really are up to date with the way that energy supply and demand is evolving away from just supply of commodities more to seeing energy as a service provider, and what does that mean? So Mr. Mansour, if you go first, and then I'll take comments from anyone else on the panel, and then we'll round off.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll just talk about, elaborate a bit more on the point made in terms of really looking at alternative means or other creative means of finance. And I think that we made some progress in the area of sukuk issues and other Sharia-compliant finance, largely fueled by the demand for large infrastructure spending in some of and many Muslim countries, GCC, but also the investors who are really looking for outlets to invest in these kinds of instruments. We have also supported other countries' efforts and initiatives, including non-Muslim countries like Ivory Coast. We've supported them through technical assistance and other support to issue sukuks and raise monies. And the potential is there. Large amounts of money, we know, in the UK and other places is being used. I have to admit, though,
there are still outstanding issues. I mean, it's still work in progress. There's still a lot of potential there, but there are still a lot of constraints that need to be addressed, in particular in relation to regulatory and supervisory environment and the liquidity challenges that have been faced in this area. So a lot of international collaboration is needed to really continue to expand this frontier in this area, but certainly a lot of possibilities. But I think also that there's a lot of scope for creative forms of public-private partnerships. And I think also that the World Bank and other multilateral development agencies have been leading the initiative to provide a platform. The Global Infrastructure Facility, for example, really is supposed to provide a platform for sharing experience, for really expanding the frontiers in terms of how you structure these, how you attract more money, more funding. And I think that these appear to be promising, but a bit slow, I would say. I agree with you, very slow, really, in relation to the requirements. But I want to put on the table, if you permit me, take advantage of the fact that you've given me this to bring something on the table, just for food for thought, maybe something that we need to think about later. But really, in terms of for Africa, in terms of regional projects, really, much of our thinking is really done at national level. And we need to, there's tremendous potential in terms of some of the resources that can be jointly exploited, and exploiting the economies of scale, the INGA project, and for example, that would really make a difference in terms of scale, and that would allow for mega investment. But again, I pose this, I don't think we have answers to this, but I think it's something that we need to start looking into, find creative means of really supporting these kinds of projects. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Who would like to go next on the panel? The other Mansour, perhaps, if I can call you that.
All right, cool. So in terms of answering your question first, Africa and solar has been in the same sentence for generations, I would claim. And that the problem has been the efficiency of deployment. That's where technology comes into place. Technology is not a thing that is cool to have. It's absolutely essential to scale. That is what's driving down the cost of installation. That's what's driving down the cost of maintenance. That's what ultimately is driving down the cost of financing even. And that is where I see the role of technology. This is one small example. The remote monitoring, ability to remotely monitor each customer, allows us to predict maintenance month in advance, an ability to plan and distribute or supply a spare part to a specific part in rural Africa. That is a cost revolution going on there. And that goes to your point as well, which was about like quality. One of the biggest lies that's out there is that you can own a product and have energy for life. There's no such thing. Products break. What energy is has always been a service business, will always stay a service business. And it's that where a lot of the quality issues have come from. That people are selling product on an upfront cost basis, et cetera, and they work for 2-3 years, but they break. So you go from electrified solution to non-electrified solution. And I think it's about time that the entire world wakes up that energy will never be a product fight business. It will always be service. So that's where I think the role of regulators in the world will hopefully come in to be able to regulate that customer experience point. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Muko.
Thank you. Just to illustrate the point Mansour is making, you know, at MCOPA, we had, we've had instances where a customer walks in or calls in and says, you know, you guys promised 8 hours of capacity, and for the last 1 week I've been getting just 1 hour. So you guys, you know, there's something defective about your system. And because of what Mansour is talking about, the remote sensing technology, we're able to tell exactly what's going on with that customer. And in this particular instance, it turned out the customer left for lunch every day at 1 p.m. And this is a customer who's 20 kilometers from, you know, our head offices. And his workers were basically using that 1 hour to charge all their various home appliances while he's away. And therefore, when he came back, he was none the wiser. And as soon as he went back home to sit on the TV, there was nothing. And we're able to tell him exactly how it was happening. And this is, you know, so technology is a big part of this. But even beyond that is the fusion of technology, finance, and demographics. The thing about MCOP and the solutions we're providing is not just a technology solution. It is the ability to have this 400,000 customers we have able to pay for this service, to Mansoor's point and to your point, comfortably, at, you know, on a daily basis, on an affordable basis. You know, the whole cliched bottom of the pyramid is exactly what we're talking about here. It's not just a cliche. It's actually understanding that bottom of the pyramid, the challenges they have. These are people who could never pay for an extension, a last mile extension to their house, you know, from the grid, but buy kerosene every day. And the ability to say, if you're able to afford kerosene on a daily basis, how can you take what you're able to afford and give you a solution, however, that gives you a lot more than what you're buying today? And so that fusion of demographics, technology, and financial services is what I think, when we talk to regulators and policymakers, trying to understand the potential of that and not to constrain it. That is a challenge we have in the future. I just want to your point, Abir, the whole thing about, you know, private sector participation in the large projects, if I'm moving out to the on-grid projects. I agree, and I think the other Mansoor made that point earlier about making sure that all stakeholders share the risk. I know that bankability of projects, especially in Africa, has been a challenge. But I think it's important to understand that capacity building is taking place. Entrepreneurs who actually put their life savings and resources into a project typically will be cognizant enough of the risks they're taking because their life savings are in that particular project. And so I will still go back to the point where addressing the risk model that we're using to apply to these projects in Africa remains a fundamental point. And I do concur and concede that private sectors have to come to the party as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I propose now just to pull some of those themes together because I think we've had fantastic contributions from the panel and great questions from the audience. We start off from the point that it is a moral imperative to address the question of access to electricity and to get away from the use of dirty fuel for cooking. But it's an economic imperative. It's an economic imperative for quality of life in Africa. But I would say that it's actually an economic imperative globally, as well as a moral imperative. Not only do we have this issue of people migrating in search of a better life into the cities and whether electricity and employment can be provided there, and if not, going on more hazardous migration routes, we also have the fact that if we could unlock this potential, Africa would be the next big engine of global growth at a time when global growth is frankly not thriving. So it's enlightened self-interest as well as a moral imperative for the wealthier nations. It's a moral imperative and it's definitely self-interest for the developing and emerging economies. I think we've heard a fascinating mix of the commercial perspective and the public sector development bank financial perspective and the political leadership perspective. And so what we're looking at is a context in which all of those players have to play their part and the policy makers have to show leadership in country as well as at the multilateral level. But they have to set that context. They have to have a very clear goal, and then they have to do quite a lot of things around creating an environment in which the developers can come in and produce a pipeline of bankable projects. Now, we heard that there's a huge market failure here, and that's for sure. But that doesn't mean we walk away from the market. What we do is we shape the market and we harness what the market can offer. As one of the panelists said, the private sector will go faster
and further and be more attuned to specific needs and be more innovative in identifying and addressing needs than the public sector ever could. And by the way, the financing need is way beyond the capacity of the public sector. So we have to have commercial solutions, but in the context of public ownership of the framework and the need to address this issue. And in that, it's not just about the developers, it's also about ensuring that we have the right kind of regulation, that regulation doesn't impede. And I would say, you know, the Hippocratic Oath for doctors, I would say ministers and policymakers need to take it. First, do no harm. So that's important. But then we have to have the developers with their enthusiasm. But the financial sector have to step up the plate. Some of their risk models, as we've heard very eloquently, are inappropriate or outdated. They're outdated in their assumptions of what the business models and the solutions are going to be and whether it's going to be debt and equity finance, because we are moving away from this commodity-driven model to a service-driven model. And they're outdated in looking at, you know, overall risk and big risk levels in the country and not thinking, is this a great project that could happen in an otherwise quite challenging geographic area? You know, one of the great things is how much technology is helping us in the grand transition. It's not the silver bullet, but it's an important part of the solution, both in terms of tackling climate change and in terms of addressing the access to energy imperative. But I think someone's just said it's the fusion of technology with demographics, and all of the young people in this room are far more attuned to using technology in innovative ways than an older person like me. That's increasing, and Africa's a very young continent. So if you get that right, and if we get the fusion with the availability of finance right, maybe we could see Africa leapfrog in the way it has done with the use of mobile banking and other uses of mobile communications technology. We had a very specific proposal from Mansour around a special fund for Africa, and I think that cry needs to be heard. Every initiative we've taken on climate finance, other people have been quicker because there's been more capacity in country. So, for example, the Clean Development Mechanism, Africa really, when it came to the party was nearly over, and it got a very small slice of the cake. So we need to think about the special need of Africa and ways in which we can ensure that Africa specifically benefits from multilateral and plurilateral initiatives. And in designing that, again, maybe we could pick up this point about the underuse of resources, where these have a viable market, but it's cross-border. So it's not just in one country, it's regional. And then my final point is what this all drives us to is the need for a much more sophisticated dialogue and more intense dialogue between governments and policymakers, the finance sector, including the IFIs, and the energy business leaders, at all scales, from the small, very entrepreneurial, up to the large energy business leaders, need to talk to one another so that we can overcome some of these barriers of understanding, so that policymakers can understand what the financing issues are, and energy leaders can understand what will be a bankable project, and the finance sector will understand that actually a lot more projects are viable than they initially assume. And that does come down to a point that's been made by some of our panel about getting the apportionment of risk to be appropriate, to rest with the people who can best control it, but to do that while not creating, if you will, a free pass for irresponsible waste of development money, because this is too important for us not to get the best results for every dollar that we put in. In the work we've been doing on the trilemma, we've got this tool, and you can see a graphic representation of it. And the red shows the success of countries in meeting the goals, and the, through all the shades down to the dark blue, and you can see how difficult it is for sub-Saharan Africa. But that's an interactive tool that enables you to look at what works, to think about what would actually help it, you in your work as a developer or a political leader. And I hope some of you may find it useful. But finally, with people like the people we've had on the panel, with this amount of expertise and passion, I'm absolutely confident we're about to get liftoff speed for this particular vehicle. And I hope you'll join me in thanking them for their amazingly insightful contributions.